Okay, it is now recording. Good morning. Good morning, everybody. Good morning, everybody. I'll share my screen. Hope you are all doing fine. Why are we so few people are attending today? 10 in total, including myself. Good morning. Good morning, Anthony. All right. Maybe it is a bit too early, huh? Still, for some people. Anyway, we'll share the screen and let's get started. Here we go. today, I'm going to introduce you so-called root locus techniques, which is the root locus techniques itself. Although it is, I guess, by the end of 1950s by Evans, I think, as far as I remember. It is such a useful method, and as a matter of fact, before those computation tools, particularly MATLAB, this method was, even more useful because it gives you the possibility of analyzing systems even higher than 2, 3. So, but after these tools, MATLAB control systems toolbox, for example, the method, in fact, gained another meaning and presented us a good tool for analyzing and also designing control systems. It is a pictorial or graphical method, and you see the behavior, or you can estimate the behavior of dynamic systems once you sketched its root locus graphics. Okay, I'll switch this on. Let us start the meaning of the name. Root is root. Locus is an interesting word. It's a Latin word. We all know the meaning of location. Location is a kind of, it is derived from locus. So locus, although it has an S in the end, it is a singular word, and its plural is loci, okay, with double I. Root is, in fact, if you consider the closed loop transfer function, all right, closed loop transfer function, it is definitely in a fractional form, and it has a numerator and denominator. So the root, when we say root, we are talking about roots of the denominator, ds, or in a proper definition, with a proper definition, roots of the characteristic equation. Characteristic equation, as you know, the denominator of closed loop transfer function. In other words, poles of closed loop transfer function. Since their locations, okay, their locations specify the system to be stable, unstable, marginally stable, stable to a degree, fast, slow, oscillating. So it certainly characterizes the behavior of a system, a control system. So root locus will show us, will give us a graphics, and depending on the location of the graphic, you may guess how the system behaves. So it is a graphical representation, and graphical presentation of the closed loop pulse as a system parameter is varied. Okay, this is a general definition. Here, the system parameter is mostly the gain, because as you know, the location of closed loop pulse. Okay, the locations of closed loop pulse are a function of the value of gain. Okay, it's a powerful method of analysis and design for stability and also transient response. Its real power is seen for the systems order higher than two, because for the systems, first or second order, no need to use root locus. Everything is so obvious. But after the order two, things become complicated. So root locus will be very helpful. Root locus can be used to describe qualitatively the performance of a system as various parameters are changed. For example, the effect of varying gain. For example, sometimes the effect of varying value of one of the poles, its effect on percent overshoot, settling time, and peak time can be vividly displayed. The root locus also gives a graphical representation of system stability. Okay. So before going any further, let us focus on the control system problem. This is a very typical. Where is this? This is a very typical control system. Okay. It's a negative feedback system, as you see. So here, I summarized here. Open loop, what is open loop transfer function here? Open loop transfer function, or as some other books use, just loop transfer function is here. Okay. Before closing the loop. Okay. So this is or you can close the loop anyway. The transfer functions around this loop is referred to as open loop transfer functions. Open loop transfer functions. Closed loop transfer function is, in fact, the ratio of this forward path transfer function divided by 1 plus loop transfer function. So forward transfer function is this k times g of s divided by 1 plus, as we obtained this together with you a couple of weeks ago. So it is so obvious, open loop transfer functions, the poles are so, their locations, their values are so obvious. Poles are, how can I say, detectable. Poles are detectable or directly seen. Or it is not a function of gain. Whereas closed loop poles are difficult to be seen. So they are a function of Okay, so you can. It is difficult to factor out this because it depends on it is one plus something and depends on the value of gain. Now look at here. Suppose that your G of S has a numerator and denominator, and the transfer function of the system it is mostly either a sensor or filter on the feedback path has also a numerator and denominator. If you introduce these two, this and this, into T of S equals K times G of S. G of S is NG over NH divided by, of course, they are functions of S, 1 plus, okay, 1 plus, of course, there's K here, okay, K N G of S D G of S, okay, times N H of S D H of S. And if you, you know, operate on this, you will get this equation. What does this say? The transfer function, the closed loop transfer function is K times NG DH divided by DG DH plus K NG NH. The zeros are okay, is easily obtainable, but the poles are still in this form, and it depends on the values of DG. Well, it is a bit too early to say for small values of K. Okay, this term is you know, negligible. This term becomes dominant. So for small values, what is this? DG, DH. It is coming from the open loop systems poles. And as K gets large and large, this term becomes dominant. And look at here, N, N. N means zeros, zeros, numerator, numerator. So the zeros of open loop transfer functions will be more dominant. Anyway, we will see that. Here, N and D are factored polynomials and signify numerator and denominator. Okay, we will see this. We will get back to this. Okay, so since the root locus technique very much depend on the complex numbers theory, and particularly vector representation of complex number, we need to little bit revise the complex numbers and their vector representations. And we will look at the complex number numbers vector representation from a different point of view, so that we can make use of this representation in a better way for to develop our root locus technique. Look at here, any complex number which has a real part and imaginary part, any complex point, you know, as a closed loop pole, okay, has a real part and also, or may have a real part and imaginary part, okay? So in fact, the closed loop transfer function is eventually, you know, it can be boiled down to a complex function, okay? A real part and imaginary part. And how can we show this in polar form with its magnitude, okay? Magnitude and its angle phi or theta, as this book suggests. Okay, so any complex number can be shown either in this what was this form, Cartesian form, or in this polar form. There is also another way, Euler's form. No need to write this for the time being. So if the complex number is substituted into a complex function f of s, another complex number will result. I used here t of s. The book uses a general function of f of s. So suppose that we have a if f of s is s plus a, suppose if f of s is just s plus a, okay, and since we know that s has a real part and imaginary part, f of s can be seen as sigma plus a is it's the real part now plus the j omega, the imaginary part. If you read this, okay, if you read this with respect to poles and zeros, okay, the system, look at here, the system has a zero at s equals minus a. So if we represent, look at here, this is s-plane, all right, s-plane, and this is f of s, right, f of s, it has a real part, if f of s is just s, okay, s has a real part and imaginary part, and in polar form, it has a magnitude of this length, okay, and angle of this angle, theta, okay? So in the second case, f s plus a, in fact, only the real part, will be changed. So the real part will become sigma plus a, and the imaginary parts will be the same. And the new m is going to be, of course, the sigma plus a square plus omega square. But we say that this is normal way of representing. Here, let us work with poles and zeros. We know that it has a zero at where s equals minus a, and there is no pole because it's not in a fractional form. Instead of using or representing this new vector in this form, we just show the location of zero or pole. Look at here now. Just we move to move this vector to the left because the zero is in the left hand side. So look at here, the m is still the same, okay, m, okay, m, and still the same theta, okay, mu, theta nu. They are the same. It is just a matter of representation, but here we can see the position of or location of A, which is a zero. We use this circle to represent a zero, okay? This is a numerical example. So S plus seven. So we are adding seven instead of to the right of five. Since zero is in the left-hand side, s at s equals minus seven, so you can show this in this one. Okay, so look at here. Now, can we generalize this? suppose that we have a function, okay, transfer function, in other words, which has I zeros and J poles, okay? So number of zeros is I, number of poles is J. And you, if you factor them out, if you factor the numerator and denominator, you can represent the numerator as product of zeros divided by product of poles. So product of numerators, complex factors, divided by product of denominators, complex factors. So if this is the transfer function, okay, we can now write the resultant magnitude and angle of the resultant transfer function. So the resultant M will be product of so-called zero lengths. Now we are referring this magnitude, okay, this magnitude M length. Okay, if it is a zero, we say zero length. If it is a pole, we call it pole length. If it is in fact just the magnitude of the of this function, and this angle is since we are talking we are interested in zero here, we are dealing with zero, we say zero angle. We will come back to this. So the magnitude is just simply product of zero lengths divided by product of pole lengths. How can you find zero lengths? Lengths are just absolute value, or just, you know, square of real part plus the imaginary part. So this is length of each zero, and the same for the poles, product of pole lengths. Okay, and how about the zero angles? The resultant function's zero angles is sum of zero angles, all right? This is summation, right? Sum of zero angles minus summation of pole angles, okay? Are they something new to you? I don't think so. Let us see this with a numerical example. Is there anything here? I don't know. Okay. Suppose that we have this function, okay? We have this f of s, okay? S plus one over s times s plus two. And suppose that we are asked to evaluate the transfer function or the f of s function at this point, at minus three plus j four. Well, in normal action, you know, in our normal procedure, okay, how can we do that? F of s for s equals as s goes to minus three plus j four, okay, f of s will be just simply minus three plus j four, okay, j four plus one divided by minus three plus j four times minus three plus j four, okay, plus two. And you can continue. Minus this, the numerator becomes minus two plus j four divided by minus three plus j four times minus one plus j four, and you can easily do this. Four plus 16, okay, divided by square root 9 plus 16. Well, it is 3, 4, 5 anyway. So you can find a number here, and the angles will be, the angles will be arctangent, you know, omega 4 over minus 2, minus, because it is in denominator, arctangent, all right, this 4 over minus 3, minus arctangent 4 over minus 1. So you can find from here a in the end, okay, in the end, you will have a magnitude and a angle. Okay, this is so simple. You can do this by means of a simple calculator as well. Okay, but we are not using this method. Okay, because we are here, we will prefer the graphical method. Okay. The graphical method. How can we do that? It is the same thing. Okay, you will see it is the same thing. Look at here, even in here, even these formula, as you see, they are not new at all to us. Product of pole lengths, that means product of, since there is only one pole, one zero, product of zero lengths divided by product of pole lengths, pole magnitudes, okay, and angles, summation of zero angles minus summation of pole angles, okay. So even these two formula is so well known for us. Now look at this graphical approach to evaluate f of s. This given f of s at this point, given at minus 3 plus j4. So all we need to do is first locate the poles and zeros of the function we are dealing with. It has a zero at where minus 1. There are two poles. It has two poles at the origin and minus 2. So all we need to do is locating one pole just at the origin and the other pole at minus 2. Okay. And this is 0. The circle is 0, which is at minus 1. And locate the point S or S1, which is which has a minus 3 as real part and imaginary part J4. Okay, then find the vector originating at zero, the vector originating at the zero at minus 1. Okay, what is it? It is its magnitude is from here to here, what is the length, if it is the right angle, 2 and 4. So it is 2 square plus 4 square, and the angle will be 4 okay over minus 2. Okay, so from here you get this from here you get 4 plus 16, you get 20, root 20, okay? So in fact, this is it, root 20, okay? And the angle, if you look at this angle, it is in the second, it's going to be in the second quarter, and it is just over 90 degrees, 16.6 degrees. And the vector originating at the pole at the origin will be, what is this length from 0 to 3, 4. So the magnitude will be 5 and the angle will be this. And this one will be, the end will be from 2 to 3, it is just 1 plus 4 square, so it will be 17, and this is the angle. Okay, so the resultant evaluation will be product of pole lengths, okay, divided by product of, just the other way around. I know my mistake, okay? I know the reason to write in this form. It'll become in this way anyway. So it is, okay, it is what, come back to here. So product of zero lengths divided by product of pole lengths. You get this 0.217. It will be exactly the same value, and this minus, okay, minus angle. So you can use, if you wish, the method to see this simple computation. Anyway, no need to spend time. Now let us come back to the root locus, definition of root locus. Let us take this simple example. What is the order of this system in hand? Suppose that K1 times K2, K1 times K2 is K. So we can scribble this, okay, simple second order system. It has two poles, okay? So K1 times K2 is just K, okay? Divided by S times S plus 10, all right? And there is a negative feedback. Well, it may represent the gain of an amplifier driving motor and camera to position the camera. It has a simple DC motor with a gain, so it can be represented as K2 over S times S plus 10, and this is amplifier. Okay, so now, what is the open loop transfer function? Open loop transfer function is the blocks around this path. It is just K over S times S plus 10. So what are the open loop zeros? None. There is no zero, okay? How about the closed, where are the open loop poles? Open loop poles, one of them is at the origin, the other one is at minus 10, all right? Minus 10, okay? And let us write the closed loop transfer function, which is, in fact, as you can find easily, K over S square plus 10S plus K. So where are the closed loop zeros? No, none. No closed loop zeros. How about the closed loop poles, which are the main interest? We don't know. It depends on the value of k. Okay. Now let us do a table. So where are the poles? The closed loop poles, in fact, will be S12 will be minus 10, all right, minus 10, plus and minus, okay, 100 minus 4ac, 4k, okay, divided by 2a2. So it is, in fact, minus 5, okay, plus and minus, can we take this out? I think we can. This is, in fact, 4, in 4 parentheses, 25 minus k, right? So this 4 can be taken out of the square root as 2, so it'll become this, 25 minus k. Okay, so this is the location of closed loop poles. Now let us make a table as the book suggested. Okay, and a table, since the locations of poles depends S1, S2, okay, give values starting from 0 and with the steps, step of 5, 0, 5, 10, 15, 20, 25 is a critical value, 30, 35, and so on, okay. And for 0, what happens? If you substitute this value k with 0, it'll become, 25 out of square root 5 minus 10, minus 5, minus 10, and minus 5 plus 5, 0. And if you give 5, it'll become minus 5 plus and minus square root 20. And I'm just taking the values from here, minus 9.47 and minus 0.53. Up to this point, you will get two, both of them, pole 1 and pole 2 will be real, but at when k is 25, okay, when k is 25, the poles will be the same, okay, repeated. It'll be minus 5, minus 5, and after k is 25, the real part will be constant, okay, and the imaginary parts will be, for example, plus j 2.24, minus 5, minus j 2.24. So it'll be minus 5 plus something, okay, minus 5 minus something, okay. So it will go like this. So this is the, these are the locations. I know, are we gonna do the same, these computations for each value of k? No, we see where the root locus graphic is coming. Now, let us locate these findings on an S plane, okay? Suppose that this is an S plane, okay? This is the real part, sigma is the real part, okay? And this is the imaginary axis, okay? So for k equals zero, for k equals zero, one pole was here, the other one, for k equals zero, one pole was at the origin, the other one was minus 10. And for k equals five, one of them was at minus 0 point something, the other one was minus 9 point something, okay? So if you locate these poles corresponding to value of k, you will see that as you increase k, okay, as if those two poles are moving towards each other, right? As if they are moving towards each other. Until where? Until they meet right in the middle, where k is 25. Where k is 25, okay? And after k equals 25, the poles become complex conjugate, minus 5 plus and 5 j something, and they move towards this direction. So they first, you know, get close to each other, they come close and close to each other, they meet in the middle as if they are moving, okay, as you increase k until or up to 25. Then after 25, the complex they become complex conjugate and they get far away from each other. It is an interesting result. Let us redraw this finding in here, okay. Suppose that we have this pole, okay, the red pole and blue pole, okay. In the first step, okay, in the first step, k is zero, k is zero. So when k is zero, we are at the origin and also at minus 10. So this is, as I said, the real part and the imaginary part. Okay, so as we increase k, this blue, pole moves towards right, okay? Moves towards right. And the red one moves this way, okay? Towards left, okay? And these two lovers meet in the middle, okay? For k equals what? 25. And then what happens? And if you increase the value of gain, you know, after 25, they separate, you know, they one of them goes this way, okay. In fact, they are not lovers. I will tell you they're real lovers, okay. And the other one, okay, the other one goes this direction. Up to where? I don't know. Here, k maybe equals infinity. But as you increase the k. So this is your very first root locus. Okay. This is your, or this is our, let's say, very first root locus. Okay. As you see, I will give you several simple rules to sketch root locus of a system, not for these simple second order systems, but systems with more poles, higher order, I mean, systems. You can easily sketch the root locus, and by looking at this root locus, you can make comments on the behavior of the system. Shall we make some comments on this, on the behavior of this system? Let us do. In fact, we did. In fact, we did. We did it before, but let us talk in here. You know, the system. First of all, and let us summarize our comments in here. When k was zero, close the poles. Were the same as open loop poles. Is that correct? When k is zero, look at here. If you this is the closed loop transfer function, isn't it? And when k is zero, the poles will be at minus 10 and zero. And we know that in the open loop transfer function, poles are at zero. Here it is. Open the poles are at 0 and minus 10. So the first finding is this. When we always start k from 0, okay, and unless otherwise stated, we always work with positive values of gain, okay. What happens if the k negative? Other approach, you know, I will give you the other approach for k negative values, okay, for the values of k if they are negative. Okay, so now suppose that k is positive and starting from zero. So when k is zero, close the poles and open the poles are the same. Okay, number two, finding number two. For or when k is between zero and a particular value, for this example, 25, poles are on the real axis, or poles move towards each other, okay? On the real axis. Well, you can say this, okay? And for k equals 25, they meet right in the middle. Okay, for k greater than 25, you know, they get away from each other, you know, as k gets large and large. You remember this, you know, in our analysis before, for example, for k, okay, so in this, at this point, for k is between 0 and 25 poles, that means poles are, in fact, real. And so the system is overdamped, right? Overdamped. And when k is 25, they meet in the middle. That means they are, the poles are repeated. So the system is critically damped. And for k greater than 25, the poles become complex and conjugate. So the system becomes oscillatory, underdamped. Under under that. Look at this sketch. Okay, it can be simply shown in this way. Okay, one of them was here, the other one was here. In fact, it is, if you just use one color, okay. So we don't have the luxury of using different colors all the time. So it is in this way. It is like just like a cross symbol, right? So can you say that the arms of this cross, does it go to the right-hand side of this imaginary axis? It never goes to this side. So since this side is stable region, right? The system is always stable, or the stability range is this. It is always stable. So these are the comments. Okay, maybe I forgot one of them or a couple of them. These are the comments. Even drawn for a simple second order system. So this is the root locus. If the system, I can generalize this. If the system has two real poles and no zeros, okay, its root locus will be always in this shape, like a cross, okay, and it starts from the open loop poles, okay, and then first, they get closer to each other and then moves away from each other. Now, what is the time, by the way? Okay, let us carry on a little bit more. Let us see the properties of root locus. As you see, we are well, here there is no zero anyway. We are dealing with the denominator, okay? We are dealing with the characteristic equation of the system. So what is the characteristic equation of the system, which means denominator of closed loop transfer function, which is just 1 plus k g of s h of s. Okay, so since it is an equation, how can we find the poles? By equating this to zero. Okay, so you will see that the beauty of this method, in fact, lies into this equation. This equation can be written as, since 1 plus k g of s h of s is zero, in fact, k g of s h of s is minus 1. Since this is a complex function, this minus 1 can be treated as a complex number and its module is just 1, right? And its angle is what? What is the angle of minus 1? 180 degrees, right? 180 degrees or odd multiples of 180 degrees. So what is the odd number? 2k plus 1 times 180 degrees. Okay, so this is k g of s, h of s is minus 1. So that means k g of s, h of s is minus 1. So the module is 1. The angle is 2k plus 1, 180 degrees, or 2k plus 1 pi radian. And k is here 0 plus and minus 1, because, you know, if this is unit circle, the 180 degree is here, okay? And you can go either this way or this way, okay? You always get this minus 1, the 180 degrees. So it is odd multiple, negative odd multiples or positive odd multiples of 180 degrees is the angle of this function, k, g of s, h of s. How about the module? Module is minus 1, just 1. Okay, so from this equation, a pole S exists when the characteristic polynomial in the denominator becomes zero. Okay, minus one represented in polar form. Yeah, there's nothing new here. So this equation implies that if a value of S is substituted into this function, k, g of s, h of s, a complex number results. If the angle of the complex number is an odd multiple, negative or positive odd multiple of 180 degrees, that value of S is a system pole for some particular value of K. But what value of K? Since, look at here, from here, the magnitude K, G of S, H of S is 1, okay? In fact, I can say that the magnitude depends on the value of k, but the angle, the resultant angle, does not depend on gain. Okay, this is small k. Does not depend on k. So suppose that this angle, so-called condition, is satisfied if angle criterion. Suppose that if this angle k, I don't like to write like this, k, g of s, h of s, if this angle criteria 2k plus 1, 180 degree, is satisfied, S is a closed loop pole. In other words, this S, general S, is on the root locus, RL, root locus. In other words, S is on the root locus for a value of K, which is as the second part of the condition, K, G of S, H of S, 1. And you can, you know, leave this K on its own. 1 over G of S, H of S. Okay. Here it is, the same thing. Okay. So S is a closed loop pole. But this is, must be L. S is a closed loop pole. In other words, S is on the root locus for K. What value of K? This value of K. Okay. And this is, in fact, we know that G of S, H of S, the magnitude of G of S, H of S is just product of zero lengths divided by product of pole lengths. But here, since K is just reciprocal of this magnitude, right? G of S, H of S. So K is product of pole lengths, okay, divided by product of zero lengths. We will see. Okay, let us, good point to take a break. Let us take a break, and after, I don't know what is the time now, it is 10:38. Okay, let us meet at 10:50, okay, and then carry on where we just stopped. Okay, see you in 10-12 minutes. Yeah, fine. Okay. Stop. Stop recording. Okay, now let us see the meaning of this, as let me write it here once more time. The characteristic equation was 1 plus K G of S H of S, right, equals 0. So from here, K G of S H of S is minus 1. This means it is a complex function, all right? So it is minus 1. K, it has a magnitude, okay, which is 1. And it has an angle. It has an angle. What is the angle? 180 degrees, okay, or plus or minus odd multiple of 180 degrees. This is called magnitude criterion or magnitude condition, and this is called angle condition. If both conditions are satisfied. If S, if a particular value of S, for a particular value of S if both conditions are satisfied, this S is a closed loop pole, or it is on the root locus. So let us see the meaning of this graphically for this second order system. So what is the here? What is the for this example? What is the open loop transfer function? It is just simply, since h of s is 1, all right, open loop transfer function is just k times s plus 3, s plus 4 over s plus 1, s plus 2, or k times, okay, s square plus 7 s plus 12, all right, divided by s square plus 3s plus 2. And the closed loop transfer function will be simply the numerator will not change because it is a unity feedback, all right, but the denominator will be, you just add them up, 1 plus k, 1 plus k, s square, 3 plus 7 k, 3 plus 7 k, s plus 2 plus 12 k as the real constant. Here it is, constant term. Okay, so this is the closed loop transfer function. If point S is a closed loop system pole, or if it is on the root locus for some value of gain k, then S must satisfy the this condition and this angle condition. For example. I'll take S1. Okay, this is example. S1 is one point, I don't know, 1.2. The question. Is S1 a closed loop pole for a value of k? How can we know if it is a closed loop pole or not? It is easy. We have to check this condition and this condition. Both of them must be satisfied. The problem with this magnitude condition is it depends on the value of gain k, where we don't know the value of gain k. But here, the angle condition, what is the angle of k is zero. So there is no contribution from k to the angle, okay? So let us see the angle condition. Okay, check the end first. Check the angle condition. Okay, if it is satisfied for which value of k, then from here obtain this k is 1 over g of s h of s. Okay. it is this is the way of checking if S1 is, I don't know, yeah, I took this 1.2. We can work with books example or our example the same. Okay, you just okay, not bad. This is sigma, this is j omega. All you need to do is locate the poles and zeros of the system, open loop poles and zeros, open loop poles. One of them is at minus one. Minus one, minus two, and the zeros are at minus three, minus three, minus five. We can check this point, but it is so obvious. I'll tell you why it is so obvious. Now, check this point. Okay, if it is a closed loop pole or not, or if it is on the root locus or not. If this point is a closed loop pole for some value of gain, then the angles of the zeros, okay, minus the angles of the poles must equal an odd multiple of, oops, what happened? Odd multiple of 180 degrees, excuse me. Now, where is the point? At minus two, minus two, plus J3. Okay, so suppose that this is J3 and point is here. Okay, so the point is here, S1. This is S1. Let us make this S2. S2 is minus 2 plus J3. Okay, so all we need to do is checking this condition first, because it doesn't depend on the value of k, value of gain. Okay, all we need to do is drawing those vectors from poles and zeros to this point that we are, you know, investigating if it is a closed loop pole or not. This, and finally this. So, this is theta one. I don't know, I'll just, shall I use the same? Yeah, why not? Let us stick with the book. Theta one, theta two, theta three, and four. Okay. Now, if, what was the rule? Sum of zero angles minus sum of pole angles must be 2k plus 1. 180 degrees, or 2k plus 1 pi, okay? Now, shall I work in MATLAB directly? Yeah, you can type, take note from MATLAB, okay? And we know that zero angles. What are the zero angles? Theta 1 and theta 2. So theta 1 plus theta 2 minus theta 3 minus theta 4. Is it equal to 2k plus 1, 180 degrees? This is the problem. If it is, we can say that, yes, this value, this S2 is a closed loop pole for some value of gain k. Okay, now where is my MATLAB? Okay, what is theta 1? Theta 1 is simply arctangent, all right? Arctangent, let us work with degrees. Arctangent degrees. Cross side is 3, 2, 5 minus 2 is 3. So it is 45 degrees, isn't it? Yes, it is 45 degrees. No need to calculate. Am I correct? The zero is at minus 4, not at minus 5. Yes, you're right. Thank you. Thank you. I should correct this. This is minus 4. Yes. Yes. Okay, so it is not 45. Great. Okay. Oops. This is 4. All right. So this is, I'll correct this. Okay. Okay, so theta 1 is, in fact, arctangent 3. Okay. 3 over 4 minus 2 makes 2. Okay. This is theta 1. This much degrees, which makes sense. And theta 2 is arctangent 3 over 1. Okay. So this is TH2. Larger angle makes sense. And it is just 90 degrees. No need to find it. Okay. Doesn't make sense. TH3 is just 90 degrees, right? Right angle. Okay. And TH4 is in fact 90 degrees, right? Plus it is more than, okay, more than 90 degrees. So or 180 degrees, in fact, 180 degrees minus, okay, arctangent 3 to 1, okay, exactly, okay, now, let us algebraically sum these angles TH1, okay, as it is here, TH1 plus TH2 minus TH3 minus TH4, if this is the general TH, okay, makes minus 70.56. Is it? Yes, very good result, which is not equal to 2k plus 1, 180 degrees. So S2, which is which was minus 2 plus J3 is not a closed loop poll for any value of gain. Okay. Now let's take another point, which is this minus two. So let's change color here. Okay. Let's take another point, S3, which is what? What was it? Minus two plus J. This is, there must be a J here. J square root 2/2. Now, exactly the same point, figure, but this 3 will be square root 2/2. Let us find those angles quickly, okay? Let me specify an A as square root 2/2, okay, 2/2, which should be around 0.707, yes. Now, TH1 will be arctangent, but the cross site is A/2, okay, A/2. And TH2 is going to be A/1. TH3 is unchanged, okay, 90 degrees. And TH4 will be this, okay. Now, what is the total algebraic sum? TH1 plus TH2 minus TH3. Yes. In this case, theta 1 plus theta 2 minus theta 3 minus theta 4 makes 180 degrees. So the angle, all right, angle condition is satisfied, right? Satisfied. That means S3 is can be a closed loop pole for k, particular value of k, for a k. What value of k? This 1/, okay, g of s, which is now it was this was zero length product of zero length divided by product of pole length, but reciprocal of this will be product of product of pole lengths, all right, pole lengths divided by product of zero lengths. And if we look at these graphics, if this is L1, if this is L2, if this is L3, if this is L4, so it will be product of pole lengths, L3 times L4. So K will be L3 times L4 divided by L1 times L2. Now, let us find those L's, okay, the lengths. L1 is a name for ladies, L1. L1 is, in fact, square root, all right, square root 4 plus a square, right? A square. 4 means 2 square, all right? So this is L1. I hope I'm doing okay. No, I'm not doing okay. So this is L1. That's 4. Okay, this is L1. And L2 is going to be, oops. L2 is going to be, this is L2. All right, L2 will be what? 1 plus a square. Okay, and L3 will be just a, isn't it? Just a. Okay, and L4 will be. L4 and L2 are the same, I'm telling you. L4 will be square root 1. Yes. Okay. So the total L will be product of pole lengths L3 times L4 divided by L1. All right, times L2. L is 0.333. So this must be not L, this must be just K. Okay, 0.333. So S3 is a closed loop pole, or it is on the root locus for K is this value. Okay. Excuse me. So it'll be even much more. Is there any point that should be cleared? Now, let us see those simple rules of sketching the root locus. You will see that several simple rules, will enable us to sketch the root locus and make comments on the behavior of that dynamic system, seeing its root locus graphics. Look at here now. Rule number one, okay, several rules. Number of branches. So when you sketch the root locus, you should know the number of branches. Remember our first example, all right? Where is that nice picture? Here it is. There are, you see, two branches. One is red, okay. One is red branch, okay. Red branch and blue branch, okay. So two branches, okay. İki dalı var, değil mi? Two branches, branch. I'm trying to be careful to not mix it up with brunch. Brunch is breakfast plus lunch, isn't it? Brunch, this is branch. We use it in Turkish, değil mi? Brunch diyoruz. Brunch. Hani branch'ınız nedir? İşte elektronik mühendisliği falan filan. Branch. So there are two branches. Where does it come from? Because the number of poles are two. Okay, so the first rule is so simple. The number of branches, okay, the number of branches of the root locus equals the number of closed loop poles or open loop poles. They are the same anyway. Okay. If you have five open loop poles, that means you have five closed loop poles. No need to say. But we are, since we are working with closed loop poles, okay, let us say closed loop poles, doesn't matter. So number of branches of the root locus equals the number of closed loop poles. As an example, this, it's our example. And then let us see the second rule, symmetry. The root locus is symmetrical about the real axis. So it is symmetrical about the horizontal axis. Horizontal axis. Why? Did I say why for this first rule? Well, because each pole starts moving from when k equals zero. So there will be one branch for each pole. But so simple. Symmetry, it is, the root locus will be symmetrical, okay, about the horizontal axis, the real axis, because any pole, if you take any pole, you will see that this pole is either real and it is on the real axis, or complex. But if it is complex, that's for sure that it is complex conjugate. So whatever the positive imaginary part, you have the same negative imaginary part. So it is symmetrical about the horizontal axis. So the root locus is symmetrical about the real axis. So simple. It's a so simple rule. So if you sketch the upper half, you just complete it by the lower half of the sketch. Number three, rule number three, real axis segments. It seems a long rule, but such a simple rule, you will see. As you plot any root locus, you will see that some parts will be on the real axis and some parts are on the complex plane. Go back to our first example. Okay, it was something like this. Okay, one branch was going like this. All right, it was going first like this, towards right, then up, and then the other branch was moving like this. Okay. Okay. So it was moving like this and like this. Yeah. Okay. So some part or some portion of the root locus is on the real axis, some part is on the complex plane. Okay, complex plane. So when we can directly sketch the real axis parts, real axis segments in this way. At each point, the angular contribution of a pair of open loop complex pole or zeros is zero. The contribution of the open loop poles and to the left of respective point is zero. You will see that this is the rule. Okay. On the real axis, for positive values of gain, the root locus exists to the left of an odd number of real axis, finite open loop poles and or finite open loop zeros. Otherwise, this angle condition is not satisfied. Angle condition was, how was it? 2k plus 1 odd number times 180 degrees. So if you suppose that you have, I don't know how many pole, zero, pole, zero, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. Suppose that this is the case. Okay. So there will be a root 9 segment to the left of an odd number of real axes, open poles or zeros. What does that mean? So here, this is number 1, number 2, number 3, number 4, number 5. But the values can be different, you know. It could be minus 1.2, 4, 5, I don't know, 7, 8.5, whatever. But this is the order from the beginning of, from right to the left, 1, 2, 3. And real axis segments exist here, left of odd number of poles and zeros. And exists, doesn't exist. Exists, doesn't exist. So here, here, okay, because it is odd number. And from here to the infinity. Okay, so this is the rule. Where does it come from? It comes from angle condition. If you take a test point, okay, for example, if you take a test point here, okay, is there, take a test point of S1 or P1, whatever, do you think this is on the root locus? And compute the angles, okay? Take these vectors, you know, from each pole and zero to this point. For example, this angle is zero, okay? All zero, zero, zero. So this is not satisfied, okay? So k plus one, not satisfied because zero comes. Whereas take another point here, okay, S2. At least one comes from here, one, and the rest is zero. So 180 degrees satisfied. Or take another one here, okay. From here, no, nothing comes, zero, zero. But from here, one, another one, three. So three times 180 degrees makes odd multiple, so there exists. So this is the kind of proof. This is the rule, okay? You either know the proof or not, but I tried to explain. On the real axis, for positive values of gain, the root locus exists to the left of an odd number of real axes, finite open loop poles and or finite open loop zeros. As a matter of fact, in our first example, this is pole number one, this is pole number two, number one, number two, all right? Number one, number two. There exists a real axis segment between the first and second pole, okay? So this rule is also satisfied. Another rule. Where does the root locus start and where does it end? Comes to an end. Another simple rule. As you remember, we obtained this. Closed loop transfer function is k times ngdh, numerator of g of s, denominator of h of s, divided by dg, denominator of g, times denominator of h, plus k times numerator of g, numerator of h, right? Now, where does it start? We try to sketch the root locus starting from k equals zero. When this is, if this is the case, when k is almost zero, so this is the characteristic equation, which is what? Which is dg dh plus k ng nh equals zero. Okay, for k 0, this part is dominant. Dg, dh. What does that mean? Denominator of g, denominator of h. Gh means open loop. So the root locus starts from open loop poles. All right. And where does it end? When k goes to infinity, okay, this part becomes negligible, and ng nh. So the root locus ends at numerators, so zeros, open loop zeros, as is the case in here. Okay, look at here. It started from poles. Okay, shall I draw it here? Our example, how was it? Something like this, right? One branch was going like this, and the other branch, blue, okay, was going like this. So it started from open loop poles, because for k equals zero, close the pole and open loop poles. Here the poles are always close the poles, but this is the special case. When k is zero, open loop poles are the same as close the poles, or close the poles are the same as open loop poles. So it started from poles, and it tries to end at, now the point is coming, the point is coming. G of S, H of S was K over S times S plus 10 for this example, right? So what is the number of poles? 1, 2. One is at 0, the other one is at minus 10. What is the number of zeros? We kept saying none. This is nonsense. This is nonsense, okay? Number of zeros is also 2. Let me give you a bold statement. Okay. All transfer functions, okay, have equal number of poles and zeros. Very bold, isn't it? But you can say that, where are the zeros? We don't know where they are. The zeros that are not seen are not with us now. They are now at the infinity, okay? We lost them, they are at the infinity. And in fact, poles are in love with those zeros. As you increase gain k, they try to catch those zeros, which are in the heaven, which are at the infinity, okay? Look at them. They start from here when k is zero, and you keep increasing the value of gain. They try to go and catch the zeros, which are in this example at infinity. One of them is trying to catch the zero at this infinity. The other one is trying to catch the zeros at this infinity, negative, plus and negative infinity. Interesting, isn't it? So when the number of finite poles are not equal to the number of finite zeros, the missing, the difference will give us the number of asymptotes, and the poles will go and catch those zeros at infinity along the asymptotes. Here, asymptotes and this, the root locus, in fact, they are the same. You will see it will become much more meaningful in a minute. Okay? So, starting and what does this rule says? The root locus begins at the finite and infinite poles of open loop transfer function and ends at the finite and infinite zeros of open loop zeros. So it starts from open loop poles, ends at open loop zeros. Starts from poles, ends at zeros. Okay. Now, shall we plot the, our second, or shall we sketch our second root locus? Why not? Let us sketch the root locus of this system. Okay. And try to use those simple rules. Okay. This is the previous example. There are two poles, two finite poles. Number of finite poles equals number of finite zeros. That means no zero is at infinity. So the lovers will meet in this world, not in the heaven. Let's see. This is minus one, minus two. They are the poles, and these are the zeros at minus three, minus four, not five. Okay, so the rule number one, number of branches will be equal to number of poles. So there will be two branches. The root locus will be symmetrical about the real axis, about the horizontal axis, okay. The real axis segments will be where? Will be left of an odd number of pole or zero. This is number one, two, three, four, okay. So there will be a root locus here and also here, okay. And then what? The root locus will start from poles, okay, and then it will end at zeros, okay. So it'll come and meet more or less in the middle now, I should say, more or less in the middle. And one will go this way, the other one will go this way, okay? And both of them will try to catch these zeros, finite zeros, okay? So one of them will come and catch, for example, this one, and the other one will come and catch this one, for example. So it'll be exactly a circle. Mine is not a very nice circle, but please think that it is just a circle. Maybe you cannot see the branches, okay? Let us, let me use colors, okay? So this is the blue pole, and this is green pole, okay? And since the number of finite poles and number of finite zeros are the same, maybe, I don't know. And this is the one. Okay. So the blue one will move from here. Okay. And then go this way. And then catch. Oh, sorry, this is zero. Okay, this is zero. Okay, and the green one will go this way and then follow this path and then catch this zero. Okay, so it will go like this, and the blue one will go this way. Okay. So this is the second root locus we have. Okay. Let us see another rule. This rule is valid if the number of finite poles is not equal to number of finite zeros. Okay, there are, for example, three finite poles here, zero finite, zero means here none finite zeros. Okay, so there will be three zeros at the infinity. They are not with us anymore, okay? They sort of passed away, okay, in the heaven now. They are now at the infinity. Those three poles, okay, one of them is at the origin, the other one is at minus one, the other one is at minus two, will try to catch those zeros at infinity. How come they can catch it? With asymptotes. The root locus approaches straight lines as asymptotes as the locus approaches infinity. Further, the equation of the asymptotes is given by real axis intercept and the angle between the asymptotes and the real axis. So those asymptotes can be found. Because so this is the sigma A, which is the interception point of asymptote with the real axis, number of finite poles minus number of finite zeros divided by number of finite poles minus number of finite zeros, and the angle that asymptote makes with the real axis is 2k plus 1, 180 degrees divided by number of finite poles minus number of finite zeros. For example, let us look at this rule is apply here, but in our first example, okay, in our first example, how was it? One of them was going this way. Okay, and the other one was going who is this keeps disturbing me. I don't know how many groups I am. Look at here. In fact, this is the point, okay, called the interception point. Okay, these are branches of root locus, they are also asymptotes because they are going to infinity. Okay, both of them are going to infinity as k goes to infinity. And also, this is one asymptote, okay, theta 1. And the other one is the other, and this is the other asymptote, okay? So theta A1, theta A2, okay? So for this example, sigma A, number of finite poles, 0, minus 10, minus no finite zeros, divided by sum of finite poles, 0 minus 10, divided by number of finite poles, 2 minus 0 minus 5. Well, we knew it anyway. And theta A is going to be, there must be as much as this, okay, number of finite poles minus number of finite, there must be two asymptotes, okay, two asymptotes. So there will be two angles. Theta A is going to be, this is the formula, 2k plus 1, okay, 2k plus 1 pi over number of, the same denominator, okay, same denominator, number of finite poles, 2 minus 0. So it is k is this, 0 plus or minus 1 plus or minus 4 k, small k, not capital, not, it is not gain, all right? So 4 k is 0, theta a will be 0 pi over 2, pi over 2, or 90 degrees. And for k equals 1, theta a will be 2 plus 1, 3 pi over 2, 270 degrees. Or sometimes I give minus 1 to get a smaller angle for minus 1, minus 2, plus 1, minus 1, minus pi over 2, or minus 90, which is the same place. So this is 90 degrees, okay? This is minus 90, or if you measure it from here, 270 degrees, okay? So let us do this example, okay? If you are patient enough, okay? Suppose that this is our system. It is how many poles? 1, 2, 3 pole. 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 finite poles, okay? And 1, 0. 1 finite zeros. That means 4 minus 1 makes 3 zeros at infinity. Or there are 3, there will be 3 asymptotes. So we need to find asymptotes as well. Okay? So let us try to sketch the root locus. Okay, our first attempt is, okay, this is the complex S plane. Okay, this is the real part, this is the imaginary part. Okay, so it is J omega, right? And where are the poles? The poles are at the origin, at, shall I use different colors? No need. At zero, at minus one, minus two, minus four. And here there is a zero at minus three. Okay, so the root locus segments, okay, exists, doesn't exist, exists, doesn't exist, starting from the first one on the left. Okay, so there is real axis segment, not, there is not, and there is. So the root locus will start from poles. Okay, it'll start from here, from here, from here, and from here. Okay, so there will be, it is obvious that this pole will go and catch the zero at this infinity. There will be three asymptotes. I think this first asymptote is this. And the second, this finite pole, it is obvious that it will go and catch this one. And here there will be a so-called breakaway point, okay, between zero and minus one. And we'll go either this way or this way, I don't know. We will see. Now let us find out the asymptotes. Find the asymptotes. The asymptotes, okay, asymptotes. There will be three asymptotes. Why? Because 4 minus 1 is 3. Number of finite poles minus number of, okay, three asymptotes. Sigma A, okay, sigma A, the interception point, okay, will be, what was it? Sum of poles minus sum of zeros divided by number of poles minus number of zeros. So sum of poles, zero, minus one, minus two, and minus four. Minus one zero only, minus three, divided by number of poles, finite poles, four, number of finite zeros, three. So this will make minus one, minus three, this is plus three, so it will be minus four divided by three, which means minus 1.333. Okay, so there will be the interception point is somewhere around here. Okay, this is minus one, this is minus two, this is sigma A. How about the angles of those asymptotes? 2k plus 1, 180 degrees over 4 minus 1. Okay, so 4, I'll write better. 4 k equals 0, theta a will be 0, 180 divided by 3 makes 60, or pi over 3, whatever. 4 k equals 1, okay, theta a will be 2 by 1, 2 plus 1, 3 entry cancelled 180 degrees. Okay, 180 degrees. And finally, no need to give two because you'll get a big number. Use minus one, you can. They will give the, exactly the same angle with when k equals two. Okay, and for minus one, minus two plus one makes minus one. Minus 180 degrees divided by three makes minus 60 degrees. All right, minus 60 degrees. Okay, so one asymptote is this. Okay. One asymptote is this, 60 degrees. The other one is this. It will be symmetrical anyway. The other one is minus 60. And the third one or the second one was this, 180 degrees, which is this, okay? So from here, there will be a, you know, something like this. Okay. I can pull a little bit better. Okay, so they will be on top of each other eventually. Okay. So one of them will go this way to catch the zero at this infinity. The other one goes this way to catch the zero at this infinity. And 180 degrees is this. This is, in fact, the real axis itself. And it is an asymptote. So this will go and catch this zero at infinity. 1, 0, 2, 0, 3, 0, they are at the infinity. And those poles, finite poles, will, or they are trying to catch those zeros at the infinity. Okay, so this is the root locus of this fourth order system. So what does this root locus tell us? Okay, what does this root locus will tell us? They will tell us so many things. Let's talk on this. Okay, so here, for example, at here, we know that k is zero, k is zero, k is zero. So when k is, and here k is infinite. So the blue part, the blue path is root locus shows the locations of closed loop poles for the corresponding values of k. So when k is, I don't know, when, if you little bit increase k, this pole will go this way, this pole will go this way, and this will go this way, this will go this way. So for k, for the small values of k, all the poles are real. So there will not be any oscillation first. And after some, this point is called breakaway point, breakaway point. We will see the meaning because it breaks away to complex plane, okay? And there will also a breaking point. There may be a breaking point, but this is breakaway point. So after breakaway point, the poles will become complex conjugate. So there will be some oscillations. And after some value of gain, at this point KC, it is some books say this is KC, K critical, because after this K, the system, when the K, when we are in here, the two poles are on the imaginary axis, the rest are on the real axis, so the system will produce sustained oscillations. In other words, the system becomes marginally stable, but after some value of for K greater than KC, the system becomes unstable. Okay, so the instability starts. Okay, so the stability range is in fact for gain K zero, between zero and I don't know the value of this KC. Okay, so this is the stability range. Now let us plot this on the root locus and talk on the root locus. Okay, and you know, you can work here safely, because it is also complex. The poles are complex conjugate. The real part is this much. It is related to settling time, and is, as you go to this part, the oscillation, as you move towards the imaginary axis, the oscillations will become severe, and at this point, it will not decay anymore, and it will keep oscillating at this point, and after K is greater than KC, the system becomes unstable. So it is like a speaking picture. It tells us so many, findings about the system. Now let us plot this root locus. It is just only one command, so that you can see the root locus of the system. Let us define this. Okay, so G is for normalization, let us take K1. Okay, so S plus 3, okay, divided by 10 dakika ihtiyacım var. S plus 3 divided by how many? 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. One is just S, no need parenthesis, but anyway, yeah, why parenthesis? And the other one is S plus S plus 1, S plus 2, S plus 4. Okay, let us make this in Z0 pole gain format so that we can see poles and zeros clearly. Okay, okay, so this is our transfer function. That means K is 1. Okay, K is 1. Now this is the simple command, root locus. Okay, root locus G. Okay, now look at this. Okay, how to make it thick in the command window. Maybe you know. Okay, look at this. What is the number of branches? Number of branches. Okay, first of all, you see they are the same plot. Okay, the same. What is the number of, it is symmetrical, okay, about the real axis, horizontal axis. It is the number of branches equals number of poles. Number of poles were four. Look at here. Green, blue, red, and I don't know what is this color. Turquoise, maybe. Four. So four branches, okay? So poles are starting from here. I mean, the root locus starts from here and go one branch goes this way. The dark blue starts from here and goes this way. Red starts from here and goes this way. And this turquoise is branch, this pole at four, starts from here and goes to the infinity, okay? So if you, the beauty of this function, R locus in G, you locate your mouse, okay? Look at here. If you put grid, you will see that, for example, here, in any point, okay? Font size, let us make 16 for you. So, when gain is 2, the dominant pole, two dominant poles, I mean two complex conjugate poles, will be apparently at minus 0.315 plus and minus 0.743j. Okay, let me see when gain is 2. Another pole. It's not very accurate. I cannot work very accurately. Another pole will be at around minus 2.28. And the last one, one of them is here. The other one is complex conjugate is here. And third one is here. And fourth one is on this path anyway. So let's make gain 2. Okay. You see it is at minus 4. At minus 4, okay. So if you make gain 2, that means you have this much damping ratio, 0.39, and this much overshoot, 26.5% overshoot. And in fact, the real part, what is the real part of complex conjugate poles? 4 k equals 2. The poles are S1, 2, R. Where are they? Minus 0.315 plus and minus J, you name it, 0.743, and the third pole is at minus 2.28, and the last one is minus 4. Okay, so since this is a kind of second order system, I mean the real part of the complex conjugate pole is really small compared to this, 5 times smaller, isn't it? So this system, let me tell you, the settling time will be more or less 4 over 0.315, and the peak time is more or less pi over the imaginary part, 0.743, okay? Settling time is 4 over the real part, which is what? 0.315. So 12.7. Okay. 12.7 seconds, and the peak time will be 5/imaginary part, which is 0.743.743, which is 4.23 seconds. Now let us plot and see. Okay, so this is gain. Okay, the closed-loop transfer function will be feedback. All right, gain is when gain is 2 times G. Okay, so this is our transfer function. Okay. Where are the poles? Look, poles of T. Poles. It doesn't like to work in this form. Okay, we can do this. Forget about ZP. Zero pole gain. Okay. And T is, and now pole, where are the poles? Oh, I see pole. Look at here. Complex conjugate pole -0.316 ± 0.73 74 J. So we are doing okay. Now let us plot this. Okay, this the same poles, you see. Okay, for gain K2. Now let us plot it. Okay. Now step T. Okay. The step T is this. Okay. Okay, step. Okay, so what is the peak time, etc. here? Now let's see how much, how well we are estimating. Okay. Look at here now. We got that much percent overshoot, more or less 25% overshoot, and peak time is peak time. Where is peak time? At time 4.66. Well, our peak time is even. This is our estimation 4.23. Not bad, and settling time in simulation is 10.8, in our case 12.7, which is more cautious anyway. So we can simulate and get the output of our system. So if you, what happened to our, I think I lost our root locus. Let me plot the root locus one more time. Okay. Okay. No. How about I'm wondering the critical value of k. Look at here. When k is (9.7) something, there is overshoot. (100% overshoot. That means zeta damping ratio is almost zero. Okay, so when the gain is 9.73, there will be these oscillations will be not like this, like not damped. There will be continuous oscillations, which for which value 9.7. Let us plot this for 20 seconds in here. Okay. All right. Go to 9.7. Okay. Make this 9.7. Okay. 9.7. And plot it up to, what was it, 20 seconds? Up to, yes, 20 seconds. Okay. You will see that there is continuous oscillation. All right. Continuous oscillation. It keeps oscillating. If you take k even greater than 9.7, for example, make it 11, okay, or 12, all right, and step, hold on, right, and step, look at here now, this is new T, all right. Make another color, okay. Look at the red one. The system becomes unstable because the oscillations, the amplitude of oscillations will get large and large. Because the instability starts. Okay, so as you see, the root locus, go back to root locus. Where is root locus? Okay, this root locus, in fact, tells us many things. If you select gain somewhere here, for example, okay, very small. Okay, very small, around 0.4. You will get you'll get overshoot without oscillation, 0.4. Let us plot this as well. Okay. Let us plot it on top of this. Okay, let us make it 0.4. 0.4, okay. 0.4. And step. You see, there is no oscillation at all. Okay. So let us stop in here. Okay. Well, we could right in the beginning, we could plot all of them together at the same time, but I don't know. Okay, you see, when gain is very small, there is no oscillation. It is an overdamped response. Overdamped response. Okay, so this is the blue one is when k is at its critical value, which is around 9.7. So the system is marginally stable. When k is more than critical value of gain, around 11, it becomes it is the system unstable. And for small values, there is no oscillation. All these findings, in fact, results are sort of dictated by this root locus. Root locus techniques are really useful, not only for the analysis of the system. We will make use of it in the design of the systems as well. Now maybe we shouldn't go any further. We would like to refine some points on the root locus, like to find the real axis breakaway and breaking points. The J omega axis crossings are important because these are the points where the instability starts. And sometimes finding angles of departure and arrival from the complex poles and zeros might be important. And calibration of root locus might be also important. We will see these things next week and start using root locus for the design of control systems, namely P control, PI control, PD control, PID control, leg control, lead control, leg lead control. So many things. Okay. You all have a great week and weekend, and a great day, week, and weekend, whatever, in this complete, so-called complete lockdown days. If you don't have any question, I'll finish the session. Okay. Okay. Bye-bye then. Where is that thing? So many things are open. Look at here. How can we be sure which pole is reaching which zero? I don't know. Maybe if we think of carefully, we may find something, but it doesn't have any meaning. Okay. I don't know. You know, we know that those poles close to each other, one of them will catch the one you know, with positive J omega imaginary part, the other one with negative imaginary part. I don't know which one goes where, and it doesn't make any difference anyway. All right. Thank you for your attendance. Bye-bye.